Minimize or let it be there.
Let it be there. It's good.
Okay.
We're just about to start, so just a minute or so more, and then we shall start.
Yeah.
Welcome everyone. The INA Bangalore chapter Frontiers of Engineering webinar. Let's start now. So today it's my pleasure to have Dr. Harish Barshilia give us a talk. Before he starts, I'd like to just read out his brief bio. Dr. Barshilia is from CSIR National Aerospace Laboratories in Bangalore. His research interests are in the area of nanoscience and nanotechnology, surface engineering, PVD coatings, high temperature solar absorber coatings, optical coatings, and SERS sensors. Pioneering research in collaboration with leading international and national institutes and spanning over 20 years has resulted in a prototype high temperature absorber coating technology, which is one of the most critical technologies for concentrated solar power systems. To explore the possibility of using new generation materials for enhanced optical absorption, his research focuses on plasmonic nanoarticles, 1D and 2D nanostructures such as graphene, CNTs, and molybdenum sulfide, I think, and transparent conductors. He has published many peer-reviewed articles in internationally reputed journals and conferences. He is the inventor of 22 patents, out of which 10 are international patents. He was awarded the Young Scientist Award in 2000 by CSIR, the Dr. Ambasankaran Award in 2001 by the Indian Vacuum Society, the Outstanding Research Award in 2004 by CSIR-NAL, and the MRSI Medal by Materials Research Society of India in 2011. He was the Vice President India, Thin Film Society Singapore from 2009 to 2014, member of Management Council, CSIR-NAL, and also he's been a life member of various professional societies. He was also the Associate Editor of the journal Nanoscience and Nanotechnology Letters from 2013 to 2016. Presently, he's the Council Member of the Materials Research Society of India, and he's heading the Surface Engineering Division at CSIR-NAL. So it's my pleasure to invite him. Before he starts, I have a couple of requests for the audience. First is, kindly please do mute your microphones so that there is really no interference with the speaker speaking. Second is, it would help if you turn off your videos except for the speaker so that we conserve bandwidth for the talk and for the speaker and his slides. Oftentimes, it does make a difference. Now, if you have questions, I encourage you to raise your hand. There's a raise hand button at the bottom of the screen or somewhere in your Google Meet window. Please raise your hand and we'll take questions at the end of the talk. You are also welcome to type your questions in the chat box, and we can again take the questions up at the end of the talk. You're welcome to ask your questions. You can even speak at the end of the talk and ask the questions. With that, I will keep quiet and I'll hand over the floor to Dr. Harish. All yours, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mehta. Can I start my presentation? Am I audible, sir?
Yes, please. All clear.
Okay. Respected Chairman, Dr. E. R. Upadhyay, Dr. Atre, distinguished INAE fellows, and my dear colleagues, I extend my warm greetings to you. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Upadhyay, who was my former boss at CSIR National Aerospace Laboratories, who gave me an opportunity to present one of my works, which is entitled on harnessing of solar energy through photothermal conversion. I have tried my talk more general, and you please excuse me if there are some places more of technical aspects are there. The outline of my talk is as follows. The talk has been structured in four parts. The first thing is about introduction about the solar energy, wherein I will also touch upon various type of solar absorber coatings. Then in part two, in pursuit of using the new generation materials such as 1D and 2D materials, we'll see that whether these materials can be used as selective absorbers. In the third part of my lecture, I will briefly touch upon the service type predictions. So for that, I will provide various performance evaluation protocols. And finally, in the fourth part of my lecture, I will discuss about various associated technologies, such as anti-reflection coating and self-coating. And finally, I will spend a few minutes about way forward to make the solar thermal technologies viable in the Indian context. So coming to the part one of my lecture, wherein I will briefly introduce to all the distinguished participants about the solar energy, which is well known, and also some of the coating technologies which are vital for developing these technologies. So if you look at the energy scenario in the country, as per MNRE Central Electricity Authority report, which was published in 2016, 60% of our energy requirements are met by coal, and 1.8% is by nuclear power plants. The gas-fired power plants, they constitute of about 8% of our energy requirements. And the hydroelectric power is about 14%. As far as the renewable energy is concerned, this is about 16% of the total power consumption in the country. And the renewable energy also, if you see that the wind energy is about 9.2%, which is very high compared to that of the solar, which contributes to about 2.9%. And similarly, now the hybrid technologies are there, wherein the solar and the biopower can be coupled together, so that constitute to about 3%. Now, but this is going to change as per the International Energy Agency report, which was published in 2014. The solar will constitute about 27% of the worldwide electricity consumption by 2050. And more so in the context of India, this number will be about 30%, 34%. So that means to say that by 2050, 34% of our energy needs will be met by the solar energy. Now, why the question is that why the solar energy is important in the Indian context? First and foremost is that the fossil fuels, they generate a large amount of greenhouse gases. And as per the international protocols, we need to reduce the generation of the greenhouse gases by 50% by 2050. Now, one of the interesting facts which is available with us is that the world's primary energy consumption is about 4.1 into 10 to the power 20 joule per year, whereas the Earth receives approximately same amount of power per hour. So that means to say that 1 hour of solar radiation has the energy equivalent to world's annual energy consumption. And as I mentioned that the solar energy is clean and abundant, so it also leads to the reduced carbon footprints. As far as the India is concerned, there are more than 25 million of people which we call as the poorest of the poor. They don't have the basic energy needs. So it is our, as a scientist or the engineer, it is our responsibility to provide the technological solution to address their energy needs. So towards that, the government of India, under the prime ministership of Sri Manmohan Singh in 2010, launched an ambitious national solar mission. It was launched in 2010, and it was targeted that by 2022, India shall have about 20 gigawatt of solar power. And this target was revised in 2015 by Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi in 2022, wherein this target was increased to about 100 gigawatt. I'm happy to tell you that as per the MNRE report, which was published on 30th November 2020, as on today, India's solar installed capacity is about 37 gigawatt, which is very, very high. This is because of the fact that India has the highest DNI, that means to say that direct normal incidence, or in the layman term, the sunshine throughout the year. Not only that, the country receives about 5,000 trillion kilowatt hour of solar energy per year, which is very, very high. If you can harness that, even 1% of that solar energy, it will be suffice for our energy needs. Now, the solar power can be generated by two technologies. The first is the photovoltaic, which all of you are aware of. In the photovoltaic technology, the photon, that means to say the solar radiation, is directly converted into the electricity. And the most important technology is the crystalline silicon solar cell. Of course, there are a large number of other technologies out there, which I am not going to the detail. And this suitable batteries are required to charge the energy whenever the sunshine is not available. Now, the efficiency of these best solar silicon solar devices is about 25%. And the way the things are progressing at the moment, the so-called the levelized cost of electricity is very low in the case of photovoltaic. But one of the major problems in the Indian context which needs to be seen is that our Indian industry imports about 99% of this technology. That means the heart of the technology, that is the photovoltaic modules, they are being imported because we don't have the silicon technology which can be used to fabricate these kind of modules. Of course, a lot of research is going on in the country to have other kind of technologies such as the flexible solar cells, the amorphous silicon solar cell. A lot of efforts are going on. But as on today, silicon is the workhorse of the photovoltaic technology. Now, on the other hand, if you see the solar thermal, which I will discuss it later, that all the technologies, including the reflectors, the receiver, the support structure, the thermal storage system, all these technologies, the expertise is available in the country. So it can be one of the technology which can be developed in the country. And as far as the efficiencies are concerned, theoretically it has been demonstrated. Of course, it has been established experimentally also. The solar to thermal efficiencies are in the range of about 65% to 70%. But whereas the solar to electricity efficiency is about 30% to 35%, depending upon the operating temperature of the device. So which is close to that of the crystalline silicon solar cell. Now, it is very important that in India, as on today, still there are villages, far-flung villages. For example, I come from Uttarakhand. There are places wherein it takes about 4 to 5 hours by walk to reach those places. So we don't have the solar energy, or we don't have any kind of electrical energy there. So it is our responsibility to provide the technological solution for the so-called less privileged society of the country. So in a nutshell, I would say that we have the suitable ecosystem we can develop the suitable ecosystem for the solar thermal technologies in the country. So that is, therefore, it is important that we should develop these technologies indigenously. Now, this is one of the report from the Office of Energy Efficiency and Renewable Energy, United States, in 2016, wherein it has been postulated, or it has been estimated, that the cost of the solar power, this is mainly for the photovoltaic, that will be about 3 US cents per kilowatt hour, and which will be less than that of the power generated from the coal-fired power plants, which will be about 4 cents per kilowatt hour. So that means to say that there's a very bright future for the solar technologies. Now, this is the map of the CSP worldwide solar power plant locations. As per the International Energy Agency report 2020, as on today, about 6,200 megawatt power plants are operating, and about 3,000 megawatt of solar thermal power plants are either under construction or in the planning stage. Most importantly, the United States, the Spain and the China, they are the leading countries. Of course, as I mentioned, that India has a lot of potential because of the sunshine available throughout the year. So accordingly, in terms of the solar thermal technologies, there are a lot of projects, but most important projects are Godavari solar projects, which is about 550 megawatt, which is located in Rajasthan, and Gujarat Solar One, about 500 to 600 megawatt of solar thermal power plants, and KVK Energy solar projects, which is again located in the Rajasthan. Now, the question arises, what is the role of the coating technologies? So we need very highly specialized coatings to harness the solar energy. So with the coating should have very high solar absorptance in the solar spectrum region, that means to say from here to here, 0.3 to 2.5 micron, and very low thermal emittance in the infrared region. So here, the thermal emittance should be very, very low. So if you see the ideal photothermal converter, it should have very low reflectance in the ultraviolet, UV, ultraviolet, and visible and NIR region, and very high reflectance in the IR region. But if you see the reflectance of typical metals, for example, their reflectance is very, very high in the visible and the infrared region. Similarly, if you see the semiconductors, their reflectance is very, very high in the infrared region. So why I'm telling this thing is that if you want to use these, either the metal or the semiconductor, we need to tailor their composition to make them spectrally selective. And in nature, there are no natural surfaces which exhibit this kind of behavior. So we need to design these kind of coatings in the laboratory. Now, from the operational point of view, these solar thermal absorber coatings can be categorized in three categories. The first is the low temperature, wherein the process temperature is less than 100 degrees Celsius. It is mainly used for the hot water applications. Mid temperature, wherein the process temperature is about 100 to 350 degrees Celsius. It is used for the industrial heat processes. And high temperature, wherein the process temperature is about 400 and above, it is used for the power generation. The basic requirements for high temperature solar absorber coatings are, of course, the absorptance has to be very, very high. We are talking about more than 95%. The thermal emittance has to be very, very low because the radiative losses are proportional to the temperature to the power 4, as per the Stevens-Boltzmann law. And these coatings are truly nanometric in nature. And most importantly, the thermal stability of these coatings has to be very, very high. So because of these stringent requirements, there's a need for the development of newer generation solar absorber coatings for solar thermal power generations. So we need to develop suitable collectors to harness the solar energy, and CSP is one of these technologies. So if you look at this slide, you find that the various kind of solar collectors, it is broadly divided in two parts. One is the non-concentrating collectors, which you use for our domestic hot water, for example, the flat plate collector and evacuated tube collector. We can have concentrated collectors, wherein we have the parabolic dish, the parabolic trough, the solar towers, and linear funnel technologies. The parabolic trough technology has a market share of about 94%, and this gives the solar power which can be directly connected to the grid. As well as the linear funnel technologies are there, they are very cost effective, but still we need to do a lot of research to make them more efficient. Now, the CSP technology produces heat using hundreds of mirrors to concentrate the sun's rays to a temperature between 400 and 1000 degrees Celsius. So in this, these are the solar fields wherein we have the reflectors, so we have the receiver tubes, and then as the relative location of the sun changes during the day, we need to have the automated tracking system. As per the Abengoa solar report, which was published in 2010, one needs about 2,000 meters square of land to set up a thermal power plant of about 1 megawatt, and about 90 meter of receiver tube is required, which is coated with the high temperature solar absorber coating. So this is a typical schematic of the solar thermal power plant. As I mentioned, that we have the solar field, wherein we have the reflectors, and at the focal point of the reflector, the reflectors are parabolic in nature. At the focal point of the reflector, we have the receiver tube, which is coated with high temperature solar absorber coating. So the moment the solar power falls on the reflectors, it gets focused to the receiver, which is coated with high temperature solar absorber coatings. That means that it increases the temperature of the receiver tube, and a heat transfer fluid, which can be either SAF or molten salt or water, is allowed to flow through these tubes. And then in this fashion, the heat is transferred to these receivers. And then this heated fluid is allowed to run through a large number of heat exchangers, which produces super saturated heat of very high pressure and high temperature, is used to run the conventional turbines. So this is a typical thing which we have taken from the Siemens, this thing. Now, the receiver tubes are the heart of the CSP technology for the solar thermal power generation applications. So we have given an example of the parabolic trough. The receiver tube is nothing but a stainless steel tube, which is about 4 meter long over here, and a diameter of about 70 millimeter. And it is coated with high temperature solar selective coating, and it is enclosed under vacuum by a glass tube. This is a glass tube over here, and this helps to reduce the conduction, convection, and radiation transfer losses. This is a typical receiver tube which is taken from the Siemens from Germany. Here in the absorptance is about 95% and the intensity is about 10%. And there are other important technologies such as glass to metal seal, the anti-reflection coating on glass, as I'll discuss it later, the high purity glass, and the vacuum encapsulations, because to reduce the thermal losses, the vacuum encapsulation is very, very important. Now, one of the important difference between the solar thermal and the photovoltaic technologies is that, as I mentioned in the beginning of my presentation, the photovoltaic technology, we use the batteries to charge them, and then whenever the solar radiation is not there, we use the battery to run the electricity. But in the case of solar thermal technologies, we use the concept of the thermal energy storage. So you can have variety of thermal storage systems. The state of the art on today is the molten salt, which consists of about 40% of potassium nitrate and 60% of sodium nitrate. So whenever the sun radiation is there, so we have these are the storage tanks. So whenever the sunshine is available, so these these molten salts are heated to high temperatures, and then during the daytime the molten salt is kept at very high temperature, and whenever there is no sunshine available, we can use these heated molten salt to run the turbine. Mind you that the thermal insulation in these storage tanks is very, very high. Now, as of today, the state of the art in the technologies, the temperatures we are talking about is about 580 degrees Celsius. It means to say that the thermal solar thermal coating should be stable at that temperature. So that is there is a very stringent requirement. Now, the challenge in the future is that we have to develop the thermal storage devices wherein the temperature is more than 800 or so, and then it can sustain the power plant for about 8 to 10 hours, so that we have the continuous output of the electricity from the solar thermal power plant. Now, the question arises that what is the role of the coating technologies in the surface modification? We use a variety of concepts which are listed over here. They are basically, the concept is the physics of trapping of the light. We are not going into the details, but I'll just briefly mention that these are the main concept: the intrinsic absorber, the absorber reflector, tandem absorber, the multilayer absorbers, then the Cermet kind of nanocomposites, and then by simply making kind of submicron roughness on a given metal substrate, also it can harness the solar energy because of its contour, and then we can have a simple black paint to enable the harnessing of the solar energy. So now, coming to the contribution of CSIR NAL, as most of you might be knowing that we have developed a Nalson coating technology in 1988. These are the inventors who have developed this pioneering coating technology, and it's a simple black chrome coating, and it has been widely patented and published, and most importantly, it has been transferred to 29 industries. Whatever in the Bangalore in around, whatever the solar panels we are seeing, these are nothing but the Nalson coating technology. It's a very cost effective electrodeposited black chrome coating technology with very high optical absorption of more than 95% and the thermal emittance of about 15%. And the surface life of this coating is about 25 years. And there are variations in this technology. Now, the latest Nalson technology is Nalson 4, which is stable up to 300 degrees Celsius. So it's a very commercially successful technology, and its market share as on today is about 90%. Of course, in recent days, a lot of Chinese products are also available, but mostly the technologies which are available in the country are based upon the Nalson coating. Now, this Nalson coating can be used in various applications, such as solar stove, solar cooker, solar dryer, solar refrigeration, solar water heater, which I have explained just now, solar heating and cooling of the buildings. This is one of the typical photograph of 1.2 lakh liters per day system, which has been installed at one of the facility in AP. And this is another facility wherein the steam is being generated by using the Nalson technology. This is located somewhere in Coimbatore. Now, as per the Solar Thermal Federation of India report, which was published in 2020, as on 2020, there were about 1.2 million meter squares of solar collectors were installed in the country, and which indirectly contributes to about 10,000 megawatt of solar power. So if you run these things, you can save this much of solar, this much of the electrical power. And but the target is very ambitious. That is about by 2020, another 2 years, this 1.2 million meter square has to be increased to about 20 million squares, which is a little difficult, but a lot of industries are working towards these developments. And of course, now there are hybrid technologies out there wherein we use the biomass and the fossil fuels to get the continuous solar output. Even though this Nielsen coating technology is a very promising technology, there are two inherent limitations. The one is that the thermal stability of this coating is a little less, but more importantly, there are serious environmental issues out there. It uses the black chrome, which consists of hexavalent chrome, which is carcinogen in nature, and it is being banned all over the world. And it is not only injurious to the human health, but it also pollutes the water, both the underground as well as the on the surface. So therefore, there is a need to develop newer coating technologies. So towards that, in 2005, when Dr. Iyer Upadhyay was the director of the CSIRNL, we started an ambitious program in the development of the sputter deposited high temperature solar absorber coatings. We are working in the area of carbides, oxides, nitrides, and oxide for cutting tool applications, for machining applications. And all these materials are very stable materials. So we thought that why not to either their composition as well as their other optical properties to make them spectrally selective. So in 2005, for the first time, we have demonstrated that this titanium aluminum nitride, titanium aluminum oxynitride, and silicon nitride, the cross-sectional micrograph of which is shown over here, this is a truly nanometric scale coating with the thicknesses of about 64 nanometer, 25 nanometer, and 35 nanometer. This coating exhibited absorptance of about 95% and emittance of about 7%, and it was found to be stable up to 550 degrees Celsius, of course, for short duration. It has been widely patented, published in leading journals, based upon the successful demonstration of this coating technology. We have developed a large number of other coatings, which are listed over here. So one of the examples is the multi-layer absorber. So what we have done is that we have used the concept of the multi-layer. So what we have taken a very thin metal layer, which is about 10 to 15 nanometer, and it has been sandwiched between two oxide layers. The oxide can be, like here I have taken chromium oxide and the chromium oxide. I can have aluminum oxide also. The chromium oxide, these two layers will have different metal volume fraction. And so if I design the coating in such a way that in this fashion, then this harnesses the solar energy, and the absorptance of this coating is about 91% and the emissivity is about 6%. And this was found to be stable up to 325 degrees Celsius in here for 2 hours, and for about 250 degrees Celsius for about 200 hours. This is a purely green technology, and it has the potential for the replacement of the black chrome technology. Another concept we have used is the nano cerements. That means to say that when you disperse the nanoparticles of suitable shape and sizes in a dielectric medium, that could be, for example, aluminum oxide, silicon nitride, or any kind of dielectric medium, then because of the quantum confinement effect, that means to say that the collective oscillations of the conduction electrons of the noble metal nanoparticles, which are embedded in the dielectric matrix, they produce some sort of surface plasmon resonance. And because of the surface plasmon resonance, we get very high absorptance and very low thermal emittance. So first, we have tested our hypothesis with these noble nanoparticles, such as silver and gold. And we know that they are very expensive. They are not, we cannot upscale them. So we thought that why not use the cost-effective coating, such as we developed stainless steel aluminum oxide nanocerment, which had a very high thermal emittance, very high thermal stability, and it was found to be one of the potential candidate for the solar thermal applications. Now, coming to the part two of my lecture, as we have been doing a lot of work in the development of new generation materials, such as 1D and 2D carbon-based nanostructures, such as CMTs and graphene, they have been investigated for their electrical properties, the thermal properties, the mechanical properties, and a large number of properties have been investigated. But we found in the literature there are no reports wherein these coatings can be used for photothermal conversion applications. So towards that, we thought that why not use these CNTs and the graphene for these particular applications. As all of you know, graphene is nothing but black monolayer of carbon atoms, which are tightly packed in a 2D honeycomb lattice. So depending upon the structure, for example, if you fold the graphene in zero dimension, we get the quantum dots. If you roll them in one dimension, we get the CNTs. And if you stack them in three dimensions, we get the multi-layer graphene. The carbon nanotubes can be single wall, double wall, and multi-wall CNTs, which we are not going into the detail. The most important is that these materials exhibit exotic properties such as broadband absorption, good thermal conductivity, and high thermal stability. So, but there are certain drawbacks out there. The most important drawback, for example, if you see the CNT, I'm sure most of you have seen the CNTs, they are dark jet black. That means to say their absorptance is very, very high, and their emittance is also very, very high. So we call them the black body absorber. So whenever the solar radiation is absorbed by this CNT, it gets emitted after some time. So you cannot harness the solar energy effectively. Similarly, in the case of graphene, which is the transmitter entropy is about 97%. It is usually used for as anti-reflection coating. So we thought we will just play with their composition and other kind of properties to make them spectrally selective. So towards that, we did a pioneering research in 2013, wherein instead of developing the CNT powders, we thought why not to do the CNT coatings. So for that, we use the atmospheric CVD process, and we use the methane and the benzene as the precursor gases, and the carrier gases at hydrogen and the argon. The reaction was done at 800 degrees Celsius, and of course there are a lot of other catalysts and diffusion layer and so on and so forth. We found that if you deposit a CNT coating, if the thickness of this coating is about less than 0.4 micron, this acts as a spectrally selective. That means to say that its absorptance is very, very high, but its thermal emittance is very, very low. We found that its thermal stability was about 650 degrees Celsius in vacuum, which was highest reported at that point of time. Now, we also looked into the graphene as the photothermal absorber. I'm sure most of you are aware that it's a very wonderful material. It has been given the Nobel Prize for its inventor, so it can be used in large number of applications, photo detector, transparent conductors, touch screen, flexible electronics. So we used a concept to develop the monolayer graphene. Please understand that developing monolayer graphene without any defect is very, very difficult. What we have done is that we have used a CVD process. We are using methane and hydrogen as the gases, and then the reaction was taken at about 100,000 degrees Celsius, and used the copper as the substrate. And then we found that just by optimizing the process parameter, it was possible to develop the monolayer, the multilayer, and the bilayer graphene. So monolayer graphene, the presence of which was established by a large number of techniques, such as micro-Raman spectroscopy and transmission electron microscopy. So then we thought, why not to use this material for the solar thermal applications? So for the first time, we gave a concept in the literature wherein we used about 40 nanometer copper thin layer, which is sandwiched between two graphene multilayers. The graphene multilayer consisted of about, say, 5 to 10 layers. And then because of the change in the refractive indexes, or a large difference in the refractive index. For example, if you see the refractive index of copper, which is about 0.46, and that of graphene is about 2.5, there is something known as destructive interference, which I'm not going into the detail. But because of this destructive interference, this structure exhibits absorptance of about 0.92 and the emittance of about 20%. Now, this is the state-of-the-art solar absorber coating, which has been reported in the literature so far. It again uses the nano-engineering concept. So it consists of metal such as tungsten, and the tungsten, aluminum, silicon nitride, silicon oxide nitride, and silicon oxide. This tungsten, aluminum, silicon nitride, which is the primary absorber here, we have used the concept of the nano-layered multi-layer coatings, wherein the layer thicknesses are less than 3 to 4 nanometers, and there's about 38 multilayers are there. And because of this nano engineering, this and this silicon oxide and silicon oxidant, they act as the anti-reflection coating and also as the thermal barrier coating. coatings. So this unique structure gives an absorptance of about 96% and the emissivity of about 15%. We have tested this thing, this coating tool, about 750. We show the data of about 700 degrees Celsius for more than 200 hours. In fact, we have done it to now about 1,000 hours. So we found that there is no change in the optical properties of this particular coating. And similarly, here we show you the X-ray diffraction data, which shows that yes, indeed, this is the there is no structural change in the coating. And this is the highest reported thermal stability coating which has been developed in the literature. Now, this slide will give you a summary of our various contributions in this particular area. We have developed more than 15 new compositions consisting of high temperature stable materials such as nitrides, oxynitrides, the oxides, nitrides, carbides, borides, and these are all stable material and a combination of all these materials. So you can just see that the optical properties are very, very good. Now, most of these coatings have been developed by either the PVD processes or by CVD processes, which are very cost intensive. So now our research is currently directed towards developing these coatings using the cost effective processes such as spray process. So we have filed more than 10 patents and 7 world patents under for these coatings. Now I will quickly run through the performance evaluation, that is the service life prediction of these solar devices. In the rightmost of this slide, you can see these two photographs, which is the one is the evacuated tube collector, where the solar concentration is about 1 and the temperature is about 80 degrees Celsius. And similarly, the flat plate collector, again, the temperature is about 80 degrees Celsius. These are used for the hot water applications. You see the other technologies, such as parabolic trough technology, yellow state technology, parabolic disk technology, and linear frontal technologies. There, the temperatures are a little higher. They are about, say, starting from 350 to about 500 degrees Celsius. And typically, when these systems are installed, the customer or the client wants the service life to be about, say, 20 to 25 years. So therefore, it is important that if you develop any coating or any component, we should have some mechanism to test the and to predict their service life. So accordingly, what we do is that there are a large number of protocols are there for the performance evaluation of the solar absorber coatings. One of these performance evaluation is listed over here. This is provided by International Energy Agency in Task Force 10, ISO 22975-3/2014. And then as per this standard or this protocol, we have done lots of tests such as UV radiation test, the salt spray test, the adhesion test, the thermal shock test, the erosion test, and the uniformity test. So all our coatings, they passed these tests. And not only that, the coatings have been validated by the industry pioneers such as the Schott from Germany and Areva Solar in the United States. This is another very important performance evaluation which we have done at the CNRS in France. They have the world's largest solar furnace, wherein the solar concentration can be about 15,000 solar cells. And the power of this furnace is about 1 megawatt. So what we have done is that we have, this is our coating, and it has been subjected to solar flux starting from 250 to 300 kilowatt per centimeter square. And this leads to a temperature of about 700 to 800 degrees Celsius. And then here we show you a partial data that even up to 150 cycle of the exposure of these intense solar radiation, there is no damage to our coating. So that's another important performance evaluation which we have carried out. The another important measurement in this field is the high temperature emissivity. We know that whenever we heat certain object, there are heat losses because of the conduction, convection, and radiation. For example, if I heat an iron bar to a temperature of about 600 and 700 degrees Celsius, it starts emitting solar radiation. So it is very important to measure this the solar radiation. So because the losses are proportional to the emissivity as well as temperature to the power 4 at that particular point of temperature. So in the country we don't have the facilities to make the accurate measurements. So we have collaborated with Professor Chen at MIT, as well as Dr. Autry from, again, from CNRS. So this is typical data wherein you can see that even at 500 degrees Celsius, the emissivity of our coating is very, very low. So that means that the coating is truly spectrally selective in the nature. Now I'll quickly run through the other important technologies such as anti-reflective coating, superhydrophobic coating, and which is what is the way forward in the Indian context. So first is the anti-reflection coating. So it's a very textbook question. So whenever I take a glass, so we find that the glass transmittance is about 92% depending upon the impurity, mostly iron impurities, metal impurities, and the about 8 to 10% of the solar radiation is reflected back into the space. It is because of the mismatch in the refractive index between the air and that of the glass. So if I can harness this even 8 to 10%, then it is possible to increase the efficiency of the my solar devices. So towards that, we have developed a very eco-friendly surface modification process, wherein just by etching a glass surface, which is schematically shown over here, wherein we have etched the glass surface to a depth of about 100 nanometer, and the etching is done in such a way that it produces the nano cones of diameter about 100 nanometer, and because of that, there is a micro porosity or nano porosity, and that results in the gradient in the reflectiveness. And because of that, you find that this coating exhibits absorptance greater than the transmittance greater than 97% in the broadband. Now, this can be used in the photovoltaic panels, the thermal solar flat plate collectors, the receiver tubes, and there are a large number of other things. Now, the requirement as in today is that we need the anti-reflection coating with the self-cleaning coating. So toward that, we have given a proof of concept. In a country like India, wherein the dust is a major problem for all of our solar devices, this is a typical photograph wherein we are showing that a lot of dust is collected on the PV panels and it reduces the efficiency. So if you can remove this this dust by a suitable way, then you can improve the efficiency of the solar device. So toward that, we have given a proof of concept wherein we have developed zinc oxide based anti-reflection superhydrophobic coating, wherein the water contact angle is about 154 and the transmittance is very, very high. So this coating can be used for receiver tubes and the solar collectors and PV panels. Of course, there's a lot of strategic applications. We can use it in the night vision optics for the strategic requirements. So this is a state of the art in the coating of fabrication technologies. As I mentioned that as far as the high temperature solar absorber coatings are concerned, they are deposited by a sputtering process. So you can imagine that I had to design a sputtering system wherein I can coat a 4 meter long tube. It consists of ultra vacuum systems, the power supplies and things like that. So to save the cost, the engineers, they are developing the batch production. That means to say that in a batch, in a sputtering system, you coat about 100 to 200 tubes at a time to save the cost. And typically these systems are very expensive. The cost is about 30 to 40 crore. The other way is the inline sputtering system. That means to say that from the one end of the sputtering system, you insert these receiver tubes or the metal plate, metal fins over here, which I have shown. And you do the processing, and then from the other end of the sputtering chamber, you get the coated receiver tube or the coated foils. These are very cost-intensive processes. So of late, the researchers, they are finding other methods such as the spray painting processes and the solvent processes, which are cost-effective. So towards that, the future trends in the solar thermal technologies, we have to reduce the levelized cost of electricity. We need to develop high-temperature paints. So the user can go directly to the site and he can apply the paint. Of course, the paint could have unique properties such as very high absorptance and very low emittance. And we need to use the newer materials such as CNTs, RGU, and spinners. A lot of research is going on all over the world to develop these kind of materials. We have to also develop the thermal energy storage systems. People are talking about high entropy alloys. That is one of the things. So the alternative technologies are, for example, thermal spray. This is the HBOF. We can have the cold spray or normal spray painting processes to have the cost-effective coating processes. Now, towards the research funding in terms of the solar thermal technologies, there are a lot of programs in the country. The major programs are the DST. They have the Clean Energy Research Initiative, wherein they give a lot of funding. And then in CSIR system itself, we have the action program, which was from 2012 to 2017. Similarly, there was a program, Solar Energy Research Institute of for India and United States, that was led by IISc, and it was Professor Chattopadhyay and Professor Basu. They were the pioneers in this particular program. It was also run between 2012 to 2017. And then, of course, the MNRE and the Solar Energy Corporation of India, and of course, the BRNS and other agencies also, they provide the funding support for these technologies. So far as our interaction with the industry is concerned, we are discussing with various industries the NICE technologies in Bangalore for the flat plate hot water devices. And this is the typical our solar absorber coating, which has been coated using the RGO based coating. Is being evaluated in the Elanosol facility in Gauribindu. Now, what are the technological improvements needed to make the solar thermal more affordable? So this is the overall scenario. I mentioned that to produce 1 megawatt of solar thermal power, we need about 90 meter of the receiver tube. The technology is available only for the 4 meter long tube. So it is envisaged that if you increase the length of the receiver tube by 6 meters, so but of course the initial investment in the sputtering system will be large, but then we can make the process very cost effective. And then improved glass to metal seed is a very critical technology. CCCRI, our sister laboratory, they have a lot of expertise in developing this glass to metal seed. And the improved solar selective coating, which I have already presented in this presentation, that is very important that we develop the cost-effective coating processes which are stable up to 600 degrees Celsius. And then new thermal storage materials, wherein the temperatures we are talking about 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius. Alternate mirror materials, for example, because the mirrors are very, very heavy, this thing. So to transport them and to handle them becomes very, very difficult. So now researchers are finding other materials such as FRP. And most importantly, in the country, we don't have iron-free glass. Today, these glasses are being imported. Most importantly, all these, whatever the materials and the processes which are developing, they should be eco-friendly. That means to say that they should be, pass the various regulatory requirements such as REACH and ROHS, because we need to be very conscious about the environmental issues also to develop these technologies. So now coming to the future of solar power, I'm just providing for both the solar thermal as well as for the photovoltaic. The future looks to be very, very bright. As per the International Renewable Energy Agency report 2020, by 2019, solar power capacity reached to about 590 gigawatt, approximately 590 gigawatt. And by 2050, this will reach to about 8,000 gigawatt, which is very, very high. And the annual value of the global investment in the solar power industry will be about $68 billion by 2030. And this will be peaking up to about $120 billion by 2050. And there could be more than 2 lakh jobs created by 2020, and which can increase to about 12 lakhs by 2050. And most importantly, 148 million tons of carbon dioxide could be saved annually being released in the atmosphere by 2020, and this can increase to about 2.1 billion tons by 2050. So let's tap this this energy, which is clean, abundant, and free. So before I conclude, I'd like to thank Dr. Upadhyay, INAE officials, both the national as well as the Bangalore chapter, the chairmen and the committee members, director CSR Anil, my collaborators, both in abroad and in the country. I'm collaborating with a lot of researchers in Spain and Germany, and of course from IIC also Professor Kamaniyo Chattopadhyay and Professor Vikramji Jasu. We are collaborating on large number of this thing. All my colleagues and students at Surface Engineering divisions, various funding agencies such as DST, CSIR, ADA, BRNS, ISRO, and DRDO. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I'll be happy to take some of your questions. Thank you very much.
Hello. Thank you very much, Dr. Harish. So I hope you can hear me.
Yeah, I can hear you, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So there are a couple of questions in the chat box. I'll just read them out for you. The first is from Professor Subhash from IIT Hyderabad. So the question is, he has a couple of questions. Actually, the first is, what is the coating material used in anti-reflective super hydrophobic coating on solar cells?
Well, shall I answer that question, sir?
Yes, please.
There are large number of technologies are there, but most of these technologies are still in the evaluation stage. They are only in the publication stage because of the fact that I will tell the fact, but before that I'll tell what are the materials. The materials are mostly the silane based kind of superhydrophobic coatings, but there are a lot of challenges in developing the superhydrophobic coatings for this particular applications. I will list some of the limitations in brief. The first and foremost is the mechanical endurance, because these super hydrophobic coatings are they consist of two scale roughness, the nanometric scale roughness and the micro scale roughness. So the nanometric scale roughness is a very important factor which determines the low contact angle along with the low surface energy. So whenever there is some scratching or some sort of dust collection, it is very, very difficult to sustain these super hydrophobicity for a long time. That is point number one. The point number two is that, as you know, that most of these coatings, because there's a lot of UV irradiation is there. So these coatings, they become very unstable if they are exposed for a long time. The point number three is that the erosion, for example, as I mentioned in one of my slides, a lot of dust is available in this country. So there's a lot of erosion, not only by the dust, the rain erosion is there. If you go to the colder western country, there is a snow erosion is there. So in nutshell, the matured technologies are still not available in the this thing. Of course, the anti-reflection coatings are available. We can have for the photovoltaic panels, what they do is that they simply do the texturing of the glass itself. They don't put any coating. Coating becomes very expensive here. So they do the texturing of the glass so that the you get the diffused solar radiation, which is sufficient to produce the electricity.
Thank you. Professor Atre, you raised your hand. Would you like to ask your question?
Yeah, very good. Thank you, Harish, for the wonderful talk.
Thank you so much, sir.
And you showed the global roadmap. What is the Indian roadmap? It's not clear to me. What is India planning in this from the point of view of actual energy generation?
Well, sir, I mentioned that by 2050, our total energy consumption requirement will be met by solar electricity. That will be about 34%. So in
That includes photovoltaics also.
Yeah, that includes the photovoltaic. So as far as the solar thermal technologies are concerned, they are targeting at least the 10% of the whatever the solar electricity we are generating overall.
Are there any specific projects now on?
Yeah, sir, I shared. Can I share once more? I'll just show you. Can I share?
Yeah, other than Gujarat ones.
There were two, three were there. I'll just show you. these are the ones, these are the major projects, but there are...
All in Gujarat, virtually.
Gujarat and the Rajasthan, mostly they are in the Rajasthan, because they have the highest DNI of about 1,400 kilowatt per meter square.
Nothing planned in Karnataka?
Karnataka, there are things, but they are not for the CSP application. There is Atria Group is there, so they are in the process of... they have, I think, one or two plants are there, but I have not visited their plants.
So there is one small demonstration plant in Calcutta. Just about 100 kilowatts or so, but it was just for demonstration.
Yeah, that is there in the in
Radharhat area.
Haryana also, MNRE facility is there. But Atria Group has some facility in the Karnataka state. I'm not very sure where it is.
Are industries receptive to this technology? Developing these subsystems, materials, coating, because always in India, a kind of second backward step whenever we talk about devices and the materials and so on. What is the reaction of the industry for all these newer technologies?
So the reaction is as follows. I should be very honest in your answer, the kind of response we get from the industry. As far as the sputter deposited coatings are there, no doubt they have the excellent optical properties. Unfortunately, they are very cost intensive. Dr. A.R. Upadhyay, once we went to MNRE and it was very, very difficult for us to convince the chairman of the MNRE because we are asking about 20 to 30 crore. He says that kind of money is not available to set up a plant. But of course, they are asking for the sprayable kind of coating formulation or the paint formulation, which are very easy to apply. So now we have come up with a patented RGO-based coating technology, which we are in the final evaluation stage.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I add something, Nilesh?
Yeah, please go ahead.
You see, I had sent my two questions in writing to Nilesh by email. I didn't understand. I had to go back to this thing. See, my question is, I had two issues. One is, why is it? Because I think it has to compete with the solar PV. As of now, in terms of cost per unit generated, solar PV and solar thermal. And solar thermal, as you said, you know, it's a lot of indigenous technologies available, but the problem seems to be you require larger area, large materials, plus you need a steam turbine generator system, and you need steam, you need a lot of water source wherever you install this, etc. So what are the factors which will hinder the deployment of the solar thermal in India in vis-a-vis the solar PV? This is my one first issue, you know, because we have to see what are the issues. Number two is, you know, I think one application...
Sir, can I answer this one before go to the next question? Sir, your question is very important, and as a researcher, I am facing the similar kind of these queries. Problem which we see is the coating infrastructure, that kind of, we should have some sort of centralized facility wherein we can do, we can deposit these kind of coatings. More importantly, there are other complicated technologies such as the glass to metal sheet. As I mentioned, that the receiver tube is nothing but a stainless steel tube, which is about 4 meter long tube. So when the temperature of the tube is increased to about 500 degrees Celsius, there will be thermal expansion. And as I also mentioned in my presentation, that in order to reduce the radiative losses, this has to be enclosed by the glass. So the glass thermal expansion coefficient and that of the metal is very, very different. So we need to have the glass to metal seal. So that's another important technology. And apart from that, so these are the only two major hurdles to upscale this technology. But the elephant in the room is the photovoltaic, the panels which are being flooded by the Chinese companies. They are very, very cheap. We should admit that one. So that is why there has to be a concentrated effort if you want to develop these technologies in the country itself.
No, but if it gets defeated in the cost and performance reliability, then I think, you know, the solar thermal may not have much great future.
No. I'll answer that question. If you recall my presentation, we are targeting three applications. One is the domestic hot water applications, wherein the process temperature is less than 100 degrees Celsius. And then we have the mid-temperature applications, wherein the process temperature is about 350 degrees Celsius, which is used for the industrial heating. this whatever quoting I'm talking about, that is only for the electricity generation. But we can do, India can do lots of work for the first two technologies, because there's a huge requirement. For example, our crop drying and so many kind of this thing, and water application, lots of applications are there. So the high temperature application is a very niche area, but the definitely for the low temperature application and mid temperature application, India has a lot of potential, and already we are doing a lot of work. And as the Nalson quoting, we have I have said that it has been transferred to about 29 industries. So indirectly, we are saving the uses of the fossil fuel indirectly.
Yeah, I know. I agree with you. For intermediate technology, no problem. But I think if compared to the electricity generation, you know, there may be some problem.
Yes, there are problems are there. But I'll tell you that, like in the far-flung villages in JNK or Uttarakhand, you can set up about 5 to 10 kilowatt of these standalone systems, which are that will solve lots of problem. We can train the local manpower, and then they can.
Hi, Nilesh sir. One request, Mr. Murthy, if you don't mind, I'll just move to the other audience. There are several people.
I have only one thing. I had written it. Yeah, one thing, this hot water is a great use, especially for the domestic applications. Only thing that you need to do is to make it as a hybrid system, that is your solar thermal combined with electricity. I think if you can develop a geyser, which will have a hybrid system, that means whenever there is not much sun, you know, electricity is there. So that way there's a dire need of developing a gadget, which is user.
Sir, I would answer that question briefly. There are already, whatever the panels are coming, this is coming along with one the electrical panel. So whenever the power is not there, you can directly connect it to the electricity. But our experience is that only for 1 or 2 months in the 12 months, you will not have the temperature of as high as about 80 degrees Celsius. But nevertheless, we can get about 40 to 45 degree temperatures throughout the year.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Mahesh Tandon, would you like to ask your question, please? You've raised your hand. Mr. Tandon, if you can hear us, kindly unmute yourself and ask your question.
I'm Professor Mahesh Tandon. My question is relating to the solar PV panels. You said that Chinese are flooding our market with all these cheap things. What I want to know is that, is there some big technology gap that we have? Why can't we produce them in India?
Sir, thank you and good evening to you. All of us, we know that we don't have any silicon foundry. The silicon is the most important technology which is used in the PV sector. So that requires billions of dollars of investment. So I don't think that the only policymakers can decide on that one. But I'll add to that one, that the other alternative technologies for such as amorphous silicon and flexible solar cells, they are there, but the problem is that they are not stable as that of the silicon photovoltaic, because of the fact that their efficiencies are low and their stability is also in question.
So it's a question of investment of large sums of money before you can start producing it. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, sir. The silicon foundry, if it is there in the country, not only it will solve this problem, it will solve all our computer chips and all those things. We don't need to import it from the abroad. So we can do everything. We can do everything in the country itself. So that's required.
Isn't that what Atmanirbhar Bharat is all about, or am I mistaken?
I'm not sure. Yeah, what you're asking.
Comment here.
Atmanirbhar Bharat, isn't that what it's all about?
Yes, it is all about, but my expertise is not on the solar PV. So my expertise is on the solar thermals. So there I can contribute to develop the Atmanirbhar Bharat.
It's not so easy. I think Dr. Atre knows the answer why our foundry problem is there.
Okay, so I'll move to the next question.
Just want to make a comment. I think the silicon foundry business in India for the last 20 years is goes hot and cold.
Yes.
We have projects, number of plants, We started from a small one, then allocated some money, then suddenly we found that the technology was such that the money allotted was not there, and nearly identified two areas, one in Gandhinagar, one in Noida. We thought we are going to put 10,000 crores and start a silicon foundry. But somehow the final decision of making a foundry in India is never taken. This is not just for silicon. Even I can point out in many other things where we have made a proposal to have a foundry. Even low-cost foundries in India government has not been able to put the money. So I have a strange feeling that that is why I said first question, India looking at the basic development of components, devices and materials that we have not invested, and I am not sure whether we are going to invest it in the near future. That is why sometimes I wonder whether all self-reliance is more of a kite flying rather than actual applications.
Thank you.
So, Mr. Marappa, you've raised your hand. Would you like to ask a question now? Mr. Sunkappa Marappa, kindly unmute yourself. Okay. In the interest of time, there are lots of questions in chat, so I'm going to zip now. Just hold on. So we have a question from Mr. Dinesh Srivastava. He says, one hypothetical question. What will be the final efficiency if produce electricity from the heated oil / salt? If you give a brief reply, that'll be great.
Well, sir, if you, can you repeat the question, sir?
Yeah, so the question is, I'll just quote it. So what will be the final efficiency if we produce electricity from heated oil / salt?
Well, the solar thermal efficiencies, as I mentioned, that the solar to thermal efficiency is about 60% to 70% depending upon the design of the power plants. But the solar to electricity is about 30% to 35%. And it depends upon the temperature which we are talking about. So for oil, the efficiency will be less, and for the salt, it will be more, because there will be more highly thermally stable. So that's a short answer.
Thank you. Next question. This is from Gopinath from Aerospace Engineering IIC. He has a couple of questions, so let's see if I can do justice to them. First is, are there any works on high temperature coatings with high thermal emissivity, low absorptivity, and low thermal conductivity? Which material combinations are recommended? This is for hypersonic aerospace applications.
It's a very nice question that we also need very high temperature, very high emissivity, as very low thermal absorptance. So they are generally known as the high emissivity coatings. Typically, all these white coatings, white color coatings, come under that category. So we have developed a multi-layer coating of SiO2 and alumina, wherein the emissivity is about, say, 95%, and the absorptivity is about, say, 20%.
Thanks. He has a second question. In slurry spray coatings, when binder gets debinded at high temperature, what leads to adhesion of coating with substrate?
Well, sir, the adhesion of the coating on the substrate is a very important aspect. First of all, the substrate preparation has to be done. The substrate preparation means either from the chemical route, you do some texturing of the substrate so that you get some sort of mechanical roughness to improve the adhesion between the coating and the substrate. So we call it the mechanical interlocking between the coating and the substrate. And as far as the coating is concerned, so the thermal expansion coefficient between the substrate and the coating has to be varied gradiently so that there is no sudden change in the thermal expansion coefficient. So if you do these kind of things, which are well taken care in the sputtering processes, then you'll find the adhesion of the coating is very, very good.
Thank you. There's a question from Dr. Basavraj. And the question is, what is the life of reflective coating on receiver and its effect on atmosphere, and how to handle solar panel, even other solar systems which are used in large area? Please explain.
Well, there are two different questions are there. For photovoltaic, we don't use any reflectors. We use reflectors only for the solar thermal technologies. In the reflectors, generally it is a stainless steel tube which is coated with, stainless steel plate, which is coated with very fine aluminum coating, wherein the reflectivity is more than 95%. And to protect it from the environmental degradation, they put a very thin, say 10 to 15 nanometer of alumina, so that there is no corrosion and erosion kind of issues.
Thanks. 7:15, so probably I should be okay. So there's one question again from Dr. Subhash towards the end. What is the scope of HEAs on solar thermal applications, mainly in coating?
What is, sir? I did not get the question.
What is the scope of HEAs? I myself don't know what it
is. High entropy alloys. Yes. There, in recently, 1 or 2 years back only, some of the papers are coming into the literature. These HEA materials are thermally stable material, but the problem is that their absorptivity is only 80% and the emissivity is also 40 to 50%. So we need to do some sort of more tailoring of their composition to make them spectrum selective. So there are none of the technologies available in the market which we use as the HEA material, as the solar thermal absorber coatings.
That's it, Dr. Harish. Before everybody logs out, I have a request. I'll just share my screen. Just one second. Thank you. So we'll probably stop now. There are a couple more questions. You can see them in the chat box, but if you don't mind, I'll stop it now. So thank you everyone for attending the webinar, and thank you for making it so interactive. It's wonderful to see so many questions. So just a quick mention about the webinar. We run it on the third or fourth Thursday evening of every month. This has been our sixth webinar. So we look forward to your active participation in the upcoming webinars. They're going to be covering all topics in engineering. And we do hope to see you again. By the way, we are recording these videos. So you can just search for our YouTube channel. Just type INLDC webinar and you're going to see the videos. Previous videos are also all there on very diverse topics. And if there's any feedback, please feel free to email me here. My email is given here. So with that, I shall stop. And thank you all so much for attending. Good night and stay safe.
Thank you so much, sir. Good night.
Thank you, Dr. Harish.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.